or going into more of an automatic rerun situation. What do you think? Why was FutureLearn brought to the fore? What are you bringing that's different from these other players? Because when you go to the senior executives here and you say, I want to go through the hassle of legal and all the rest of it to build another contract, you know, what do you feel that you're bringing to the institutions that's new, that's fresh, that is critical and of importance?
So there are, frankly, I mean, there are sort of fundamental commercial realities behind some of what's going on. So the reason for moving to on-demand and those kind of sort of courses on a perpetual loop is a response to what students want and what employers are looking for. There's no question that in a segment of the market, if you're looking for short courses and professional development and those sort of things, skills-based type of things, which you want at the time when you need it, then there is tremendous value from having an on-demand type of system or making courses more readily available for when people need it. And that's clear. There's no issue with that. But that's right for some markets. But that there's a trade-off always there with that, because what are you delivering? Part of the challenge with moving to on-demand is you start to get to a much more, again, instructionist content delivery mode, because you can't have individual academics or educators intervene on courses that are on a perpetual loop unless you're going to staff that, and you'd have to have tremendously high costs then involved in that, and therefore you wouldn't be able to run it on a loop. So it becomes, you know, I've coined a sort of phrase of an academic lynda.com. You know, it starts to move into that kind of world. There's value, but what we're trying to say is there's other things that we can do. And part of this goes back to the comments I made before, which is how do you support universities in their core business to do that better? And now we are going to university thinking, actually, what is your digital strategy? And actually, you are investing not in MOOCs, you are fundamentally investing in digital assets. And those assets can be used in multiple ways, those same assets. And it's about how do you use those effectively with different audiences. And what we would love to see is universities thinking, actually, I can serve a general interest market. I can either do it through open educational resource, I'm going to make some of this just out there. It's good knowledge. You should see it, and actually that bite-sized component is good in itself and will serve an educational need. The other thing is, actually, no, I'm going to scaffold it to create a learning outcome. But it's still general interest. It might be helping you to recruit. It might be propagating some of your research to have impact in society as part of grants or other things. And you don't need anything more than just the learning outcomes. But then you say, well, actually, we can have CPD opportunity here. There are actually people who want to learn this and apply it in their work setting, and it'll be really useful. But they need proof of that learning, and they need other things that may be wrapped around it, proof of idea and assessment. So let's add the certification level to this. But we don't need a separate course for those people. They can be studying with the general interest people who've also got an interest in that topic, and still learning from each other and getting the knowledge and sharing that that community can bring. But hang on a second. We can use the same material on campus, can't we? Or for our distance students. And can't they be learning exactly the same from these other students? So why would we compartmentalize it and put it in a walled garden somewhere else? If the value is actually learning from other people, let them learn from all the other people. But then we have to top it up, because for credit and for that in deeper learning, we're going to put some other TMAs, teacher marked assessments. We're going to put in some live interaction. We're going to structure some group activities that can be either done with the technology, if it's good, or not with the technology. And actually, then you get all that great value from your investment in the content. You are enabling the world to come in together to study with your students. You're giving your students a chance to interact with a much broader set and see the sort of experience. You're also gathering a ton of other data from across the world to inform course design and to market test what your courses need to do to improve them and refine them in an agile way. And that's what we can do for universities, which is transforming what you can do and serve multiple markets at the same time. That's different and distinct from saying, I want to go after short course revenues as a supplement to my business. And yes, it's very lucrative, but almost compartmentalized, as traditional online programs have always been and started as a sort of separate, discrete activity complementing the core business, but primarily as a revenue generator. It wasn't used to disrupt what's really going on. And a lot of universities, when they've embarked on MOOC programs, have said, you know, we're doing it for the, you know, some of the soft things. We want to learn from it. But it seems like, you know, the danger now is a handful of people have gone off and done MOOCs. They've transformed their own practice in some ways, because for the first time they thought about how do you teach and what are my learning outcomes, because they can't be there. But then it stops, because now the money has come in. And it's like, well, actually, now we need to generate this income. And unless it's doing that, it's not going to work for us. So, okay, well, now we're going to sort of worry about learning design somewhere else. And we just need to generate income. We're just saying, no, hang on. We're about a pedagogy of massiveness. We're about striving forward learning outcomes and developing scaled education, which is what we should be doing, to try and move things forward and educate a much larger group of people and change the experience. And it should be sustainable. And it may unlock these other opportunities. But it doesn't need to be a zero-sum game between one and the other.
You said a word that immediately raises my hackles. But at the same time, I know it's a reality. And that word was compartmentalized, okay? And which is a bit of a disease of institutions. You know, you build your tower, and then you build a moat around the tower and all the rest of it. Who's taking this learning from these online courses that FutureLearn is offering, et cetera? Who's taking that learning on an institutional level and working correctly with it? Who do you think is doing the best job with regards to actually building it back into the strategy of your organization?
That's a hard one to answer. I mean, I don't think there are a few that I see amongst our partners who are definitely trying to do that. And it's linked to, there's a few things that we've put in place to try and help universities do that. There's a FutureLearn academic network where the researchers from all the university partners come together to try and research on the big data sets and then draw that back into their institution. I think some of the most forward-thinking institutions, I'll pick a couple, but there's several more. But, you know, the University of New South Wales, an incredibly forward-thinking institution around how they're going to use digital technologies, have a much clearer strategy around sort of really going for a blended experience and how do you think about MOOCs in that context? University of Leeds that you see actually on our platform has lots of courses. So they think about how do they use these courses to recruit students in, lots of short, bite-sized pieces that they can repurpose and reuse in different ways for undergraduate studies, but also thinking actually how do we use, you know, how these are new online programs that they might, you know, want to do in the future. So they're thinking, you know, they're all thinking very hard, some of these institutes, about how they take what they're doing as pure MOOCs and integrating it into their systems. And I think what we need to do more of is actually creating the change in the institutions. So where they're all at now is how do you get the right conversation to happen internally? How do you get the strategic discussion about, well, how do you take that big shift from being just a pure campus-based institution living in more traditional ways to a blended institution? How do we think more openly about this? And it challenges so many structures, systems, incentives. You know, it's fundamental. And, you know, that's why I'm not seeing lots of it at the moment, because actually it's only been going for some of these places about 2 years. So they need to go through. Now they're getting some lessons. Now they're thinking hard. Some of them are making some fundamental decisions. Are we going to be campus or are we going to be into full online programs? You know, that's a huge decision for some of our universities. They're all elite. There's not a burning platform under any of them necessarily, but it's a case of can we improve what we're doing and solve real problems? But does this help also prepare us for a future where it's going to be more digital? And then how do we do that and who's ready to do that? So it's a slow process that's going through, but they are having it now. I know partners are beginning to take the leap, and you'll probably hear some more things from the FutureLearn partnership anyway in the course of this year.
I noticed with Leeds, and Leeds is known, right, for doing innovative partnerships with like Manchester and the likes. But one of the things that I was fascinated by with what they're doing is actually a nomenclature technique that they're doing, which was really trying to own the word innovation in some of the MOOCs that you've got, where they're like innovation in engineering, innovation in healthcare, innovate, you know. And are you seeing more of these universities trying to own specific areas, and what's emerging in that realm?
I think so. It goes back to some of the advice we've given partners. So there's a feature we've done on our platform, which is you don't need to register to be able to see some of your delivered content. So your videos and your articles, all controlled by you, can be allowed to be indexed on Google, then will be therefore discovered, shared with others. And it can also then, under that piece of content, would be a call to, you know, highlights of other things you could see that have been made freely available and floating around the internet, and then draws people into a course. So you have not the front door, there's 10, 20, 50 front doors in. Part of the logic for that is it's a great way of recruiting people into the course, because people then can search for your terms related to that area and keep finding your videos and ways to come in. But the other thing it means is your digital footprint for particular areas of expertise where you want to be strong can be much, much larger. So if you think actually one of your, you know, specialisms is around of agriculture or cybersecurity or whatever it is, or architecture, the more courses you have, the more that you then open each individual page up and you cut and you optimize it for search, you are literally all over your materials will be all over the web. So it's a fantastic for leads and others who are doing this. It's a great attempt to recruit people using the power of Google and other things, which is how people are ultimately discovering courses online.
You brought up, and I want to explore the social collectivism as an approach to education. And I know that a lot of us around the table here, potentially some of those online, the only way they're going to think about a MOOC is if I have to do it for my NSF grant, right? And we've got one of those situations here at this very table that I'm very familiar with. And yet, so many of the platforms out there right now, are they really doing social? Because that's how the NSF is looking at it, you know, what social elements are you doing to spread the word of this specific area of expertise?
Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about where the social collectivism came from, how you're using it, how you're using it differently?
Can you just, before I answer, can you just, on your term, definition of social collectivism, are you thinking of the open pages, or are you thinking of the social within?
I'm thinking more, it's kind of a little bit of both, but more so within the actual course and the interaction of the individuals. Because to your point, you know, a lot of these on-demand models are like lynda.com on steroids.
Yeah.
You know, what do you see the benefit is of the social, and how are you designing it to be more social,
yeah,
to be more engaging? And quite frankly, what can we learn? This is a three-part question. Have you noticed how I can go on a bit? And how might that impact how we actually work with our students on a campus level, not just online?
So what we're doing to improve the conversation elements, I mean, it's really, the platform is just a piece of technology. Okay, so we built it with social constructivist principles underpinning it because we want to enable people to knowledge share in a sort of constructive way, you know, around particularly relevant pieces of content. And we want people to be able to have discussions at a level of description, able to think about concepts and interrogate the concepts without, you know, without the other material being presented. And we want people to be able to find other people. So what we've effectively done in the platform to enable the social part to happen is to make sure you have a conversation directly next to content so that you don't have a fora where you have this random conversation where eventually somebody starts talking about their dog or something else, and it goes off on a tangent, and you can never keep the thread going. So actually linking one video or one article directly next to a discussion about that, which you can then model answers or curate in some way to keep people on track, is the first thing. So you get that water cooler, the conversation you want. Then after that, it's about making sure people have a dialogue rather than just posting comments. So replying is obvious, but then how do you help people find the most relevant conversation? We introduce liking so that people can like and filter on the most liked conversations in a particular thread. So that means you start to see, if you haven't got time to go through the 300 or 400 or even 1,000 comments that might be sitting on one particular thread, you can find the best things that most people are enjoying. The final one is actually introducing profiling and following. So we wanted people, we want to build a social community. It's about a network, a growing, ever-growing network of people who are trying to learn together and learn from each other. So we want a personal profile. We want your real name, so you take ownership for the comments that you make, and you can form real relationships. But then we said, okay, in those discussions, when you're seeing all those comments, you might find people you're learning from, and also the educators. I don't want to see everybody's comments. I want to see that for part, just to get a sense of things, and vicariously learn from the comments and ideas of others. But I want to filter it to be able to have better conversations with a few, either people I know or people I'm finding in this course that are actually adding value, and talk to them easily. So we've introduced following so that you can filter those conversations to all the people you're following. And then we've done finding your own conversations again. So actually you can filter that on all your own conversations that are going on. And then there's one place where rather than finding it on a particular step, so if you've got a one piece of video and there's all those conversations alongside it, and actually you've got conversations in multiple ones, you don't have to keep finding them. There's one place where you can see all the comments coming in and all the comments from your particular group of people you're following and all the replies you've had. So you can have a much more seamless chat with those people. So that's the way we're trying to stimulate the conversation and the knowledge sharing. And that's what helps people have more, rather than just posting comments, have an ABA type of exchange around the discussion. The other thing that we're doing, obviously, encouraging universities to have somebody there. So an educator presence is really valued. We don't really want to see them disappear from this. It doesn't take a heavy amount of involvement, because you're not there to answer questions. You're there to provoke them. So actually, as soon as somebody answers the questions, as soon as an educator comes in and answers the question, it kills conversation. Because nobody feels that they can actually argue back unless they're another, you know, expert, which they do. And then some of the educators have got really annoyed that, who's this person to challenge me? I'm the my course. And they said, well, actually, no, they're really smart. They have, you know, they've got a point of view. But, you know, that takes some, for some, a little getting used to. But you shouldn't answer. You should ask more questions. You can really say, just like a comment, you know, signal to the community that you endorse that comment, and that you know, we tell them that the educator liked it. That's a big boost for that individual, and then you can know from this we can build community rating tools for how much, you know, learners are who are valued by the learners. We haven't got there yet. But the other thing that's really important is your own learning design. I just tell you, we're a tool that has been built to enable good design to happen and tries to give you the flexibility, the pedagogical Lego bricks to build an experience that is social and that engages people. And part of that is then rethinking how you construct a course and a curriculum. It's saying it's not about presenting our material, going off and trying something out and then checking that you've learned it. It's saying let's rethink this. It's as children do, they play with something. They, you know, they come with a new concept or a toy, even, you know, at a very basic level. They play with it. They don't wait for an explanation how to use it, because they just want to get into it. So you give them a chance. Give them the big question. You know, if it's a philosophy course, does God exist? Right. Everybody can have a go at that question. Everybody can have a point of view on that question at the beginning of a course. Right. Without you imposing your structures. But it helps them think, it helps them challenge each other, see what they understand, what they don't, and then you can start to impose some enlightened but confused, and then you can, wow, aha, now those are the questions I should have been asking, and then suddenly people start to you know, restructure their thinking, and they've learned. So it's that playing, it's storytelling, it's creating engagement, it's using the tricks of media to create cliffhangers and suspense. That's what you want. And the beauty of this platform, because at the moment the courses are for credit and they're sort of different, means that you can play. Great bit of advice Strathclyde University gave to its academics when they designed their forensic science course, which was a murder mystery, in effect, teaching you the different techniques of forensics. They said, just go play. Just do something you wouldn't do ordinarily. So they did. and it was a fantastic success. They had no idea that the case study and doing a murder mystery would be the compelling part. But it was fantastic, and people were literally, the only thing they got wrong, I think, on that course, on the first time they ran it, is that they revealed the murderer on Valentine's night.
Oh,
14th, at 8 o'clock in the evening. So people were just complaining they had to reschedule dinner till 9:30 because they really wanted to find out who it was. But that was, you know, it still made for some great anecdotes. But that's what you can do. You can get people talking about these courses in the offices and with their colleagues because they just get wowed by the storyline. So it's just taking the tricks of good education, good learning design, and good storytelling together to create conversation.
Personal question. Size. Okay, size of universe, size of actual MOOC, length of MOOC. Is size important? I suppose it's
I've just seen an article
question
about something else which says it is. But
because a lot of what people say are some more supported MOOCs that have been out there longer. They're like, well, they have 17 million circulation. I've got to be in on them. But the person you're talking to is doing geo design or maps, and you know, what are your thoughts on this?
I think it's all about what's your goal. So everybody talking about, you know, everybody's been fixated on the M, this whole acronym, and that's powerful. It's important to us because we're developing a pedagogy that's trying to advance learning for thousands of people at a time. And that's a worthy goal because education is globalizing, need is, and there's much more efficient ways of doing that, and we can find ways to improve, enhance, or give an equal experience to more and more people. So there's a value in the M, and there's a value in the M for recruitment, right? And for revenue generation. But then even then, those tend to be introductory courses. You know, the ones that are getting tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands, I should say, you know, in the past, for all the basics. But actually, if you go after the intermediate level, a more advanced level, it's not about then getting hundreds of thousands. Actually, you want the committed few thousands who really are learning from each other. You've got some real experience to share. It's the reason why you go to business schools and postgraduates, because actually it's the people you're going to meet and their knowledge that is going to help you. So actually you don't need tens and hundreds of thousands. What you want is a good collection of people who can help each other learn. And if you're thinking about what works then integrating on campus to enrich the experience, it's not reaching all of that number. It's to get in a new audience to enrich the experience who may be doing it for CPD, as I've talked about before, your separate cohorts, or who may be doing it because they want credit, and they may switch. And they could be a registered student who says, you know what, I can't do the full program anymore, but I would like to get something out of it, and there's a route for me to do that. Or actually, CPD, I didn't really know how great this would be, and I could see myself moving this direction, and I would like to move into a credit-bearing program. And you just give the ability to do that. So I think it's all about what are you trying to get out of the courses that you're putting together. Some of that, and the ideal would be you can get some recruitment, but then you're also transforming the experience, and you can give more flexibility to people to do that. And none of it should be wasted. So your investment, again, it goes back to the comments before, when you invest in the digital content, it will have multiple uses. And it's about saying, well, we will already use this for a set of students, and it's already going to transform what they do. But we've got a chance to do either bring more people in, because it's open, or we've got a chance to recruit more people or serve certain markets. And that's what it's really all about. So I don't think we should all get fixated on the M. And this, the M is important for the goal that you have. It's also about the openness. It's also about the learning experience. It's also about serving even other markets, corporates. Mm-hmm. No, you can turn this. We talk about fixating on the O, but actually delivering a scaled experience within organizations or even across organizations. I mean, all the business techs from there. You know, businesses are not now islands in themselves. They have to work with suppliers and integrate them very closely. They have to work with distributors, and they want them to work better together. They want to have shared values, shared understanding, shared language. Getting them to have a short course which they can deliver across organizations that are close strategic partners to get a better outcome and better language set amongst themselves could also be valuable. So none of this stuff is lost, and there may be a few hundred people that's always relevant. So don't get fixated on any part of the acronym.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to ask you, there's a wonderful example of this that we're familiar with, and I'd like to open it up, Larry. The Ebola MOOC that occurred, because, you know, we've got what I hear a lot as well is, well, you know, this is a very important person in faculty, and they do not have the time to do this. And that's true, and they are important, and they're going to the UN and all the rest of it. So can you share the Ebola story?
So this is... there were two courses. I think it's the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine, further in context. So that had Professor Peter Piot, who was one of the co-discoverers of Ebola, who's director of the school. Yes, he's a fairly busy individual. So he was not the lead educator on the course, and there were others who came into to be the lead educators who are also professors or experts in their field. They don't need to be doing lots on the course. Effectively, Peter Peel did a cameo role introducing it, and they had other footage in there. So that was done, and that was just, that could be part of your marketing. So actually, if you want the really big name, who are your superstars that people want to come and listen to? That doesn't need to be the person leading the course. People want to see what they've got to say. They don't need to see them across the course. Then you need to have who's the respected lead educator. But they're going to make sure that their quality is sure. They're signing off. Work can be allocated to other people who are smart enough to put these things together. But they just want to make sure that the course learning outcomes are being, and it's what they would like to communicate from it. So again, even their role can be constrained. And then they can turn up, if they want to post comments at a particular point in the course. But again, not the whole time. A lot of this now is allocated out to PhD students, or even in some cases, you know, master's students who are doing the program have done that module before, and then can just be there to mentor and provide extra support. So it's the responsibility of the lead educator, the experts, which was very minimal. What they cared about was making sure that what they put out, their primary exam, was of really high standard. It was going to be with them and their institution a critical area of their work. They wanted to make sure whatever was done was just really high quality. So they could set the parameters around that. They could provide some content into it. After that, it's trusting the people beneath them to do the good job.
And what was the length of that course?
2 weeks. Now three, but it's two. It was 2 weeks when it started, and it was fantastically received. And it was fantastically received as much because of the comments of, again, of the people on the ground. So you had all the people at Sierra Leone and other affected areas commenting and talking, sharing issues, really bringing to life not only the clinical elements of decoder and how it's transmitted, but the practical dimensions on the ground, the human dimensions, which are making it so difficult, because of obviously struggling with pregnancy and people, burying people and not washing their hands because of it and because of the rules there. So how do you deal with that spread? How do you deal with all that complexity, which is not dealt with in other things? But that sharing was what I got lost in that course by reading the comments of other people. The videos were great, and the articles and other things were very useful and very insightful. But I was just blown away by what I was reading, and obviously given how topical it was, it was important.
So, Mark, I think that's a perfect segue into a question we have from one of our guests online. Andrea is asking about the kind of feedback that you've received from the learner experiences in FutureLearn, and how does that compare? And I think she's speaking interaction-wise, the connections which you just spoke about, that drawing experiences in from the field. How does that compare to what we might be able to do in LMSs? What are the differences there?
I think it's hard for me to do the comparison because I haven't seen other data. I can say what learners are saying to us. I mean, we have very high feedback from our learners. And it's like 96% average of people saying the course is either excellent or great. And when it comes to the social side, I think the best thing I can point to, you get, every course is the most online. When people get to the end, they're writing, oh, what a wonderful course. Right? So that's not, I don't take that. But give an example of a global pharmaceutical company that we've been working with. We deliver courses privately to them. And as part of an evaluation of, is FutureLearn delivering a better experience, should we continue using them? They asked the 150 or 300 learners on the course, how would you rate this versus your existing learning system that we're using for delivering of other e-learning? Like 99%, much better. More of this, please. What a great way to learn. We love the commentary. This is fantastic. And so that, it was like 99% for 80% or whatever, all saying just how fantastic the engagement was. And we know from, there was a World Health Organization report done with Imperial College London about e-learning and how can it be used for undergraduate studies, for doctors and nurse training, because there's such a shortage. And they're saying the biggest drawback of e-learning is that there's no engagement with other learners. You feel isolated in another mode, and they would love more interaction. And that's what we've addressed. So we weren't surprised to get feedback like that, because the chance for people to meet other people within their global organization and talk and share their experiences is what was really important. So is it better than other systems? I know what we're delivering is really valued. And it was compared to one system. How many others? I'm sure it's a lot better. The fact that some of our university partners are asking us, can we use the platform for their own students, for me is a significant endorsement that it's better than what can achieve on other systems.
Terrific. Thank you. And that there's a word that Kyle copied down a couple minutes ago that you used that I think captures this spirit, and that's the social collectivism. Using the base of everybody involved in the experience. Let me turn to the room and see if we have any questions internally here. Online, if you have questions. Would you mind, Kyle, would you give her the mic, please? Just introducing yourself for our guest.
So my name is Crystal Ramsey. I work at Teaching and Learning with Technology. And my question is about, once we start looking at credit-bearing models, or for the students who are interested in receiving credit, what, we talk about feedback that students offer about their engagement level and so forth, but what kind of feedback do they get about the extent to which they're meeting expectations, and are they really learning, and how do we decide, how do you decide whether students are actually learning what they're supposed to be, regardless of engagement?
Mm. Goes back to, yeah, there would be great ways to, we haven't implemented yet, to sort of try and figure out whether people are really learning. But it goes back to one of the worst ways of having to do it, which is classic assessment, right? So that's how all of us here, I think, in most programs, figure out whether somebody's learned what they're supposed to have learned, is by testing them. Now, we assume, you know, there's no, I would love to have more evidence that people are genuinely learning. And I think most platforms are not in this position able to say how much people have learned. We know from research what we think leads to improved learning outcomes, which is why we base the platform on constructivism, because we know that people who actually get engaged with their learning actively will learn more, should learn more. It's why we have practical activities, because actually sit back experiences don't help learning. Practical engagement in activities, thinking about them and reflecting and discussing with others, aids learning. So what we've tried to do is make sure that the inputs are research-driven and underpinned. And we therefore are hoping, therefore, that these are learning to learning outcomes. But it's assessment which we will use. And, you know, if people are doing well on those assessments, that's what we will use. Now, we're for a credit setting, we're saying, you know, it's not multiple choice quizzes. We'll take go, you need a formal summative assessment, and that can be then a written assignment. It's not going to be multiple choice quizzes for that. You know, and or it could be something, what we're trying to do now, submit a tutor marked assessment, as well as then do a summative assessment. So you get multiple ways of trying to evaluate whether somebody's understood and learned from that. But I think we're struggling with as much as, I wish the same burden was put on some campus provision as sometimes is the spotlight shone on MOOCs, because I think that would improve everybody's outcome.
My, Crystal, my version of how that might happen is that they might learn through the FutureLearn system and then jump through a link out to our Penn State badging system to submit evidence and be reviewed, if they're working with us for credit. So if it's a peer-reviewed badge and we want to educate the masses of tens of thousands of people, I think that's good, and there should be some sort of a peer review option for higher order outcomes. So there's the lower level comprehension, and those things can be tested. Then for the higher order products, I think they should come to us, pay what it costs us and maybe a little more to for each assessment, and then we provide those assessments.
So that's a good prompt, because one of the things that we're doing now, so we've always done it, but now it's the credit conversation is picking up amongst the partnership, is we are now trying to integrate more firmly into your system and ways of doing this assessment. So what we want to do is to enable universities to add premium activities into an open course. So actually you say, well, actually, here's a TMA you can submit as part of this program, or here is a locked bit of content. You can pay to unlock it, but it's premium. There may be a synchronous activity in there, or a group collaborative activity, or something else. And you do that. And then also there's a summative assessment, where you can go to one of our partners who can deliver the exams across the world, and you submit that piece of work. And what we're trying to make sure is that two things are one, that we can happen. One is that if they're not a registered student, we have a process for registering with the university at the point they're going to have to take the assessments, which is necessary in the UK at least, to award credit. The second is that the duty of care to make sure that you're not sending students to paying to take an exam which they're going to likely fail. They're not adequately prepared. But you find a way of ensuring that they know that they're okay and they can signal officially to you that they feel ready to go and take that exam. So that duty of care is there. And then what we want to do after that is to make sure that any test results that are done can feed seamlessly back into your back office system. So it's not about integration. It's the way the world is going. Actually, you want to modularize different components into a back office system so you can deliver the best assessment tools that you need for the job, best learning system you need, and other things, and simulations and virtual labs that can all plug in together and be updated more easily rather than a single LMS system. But, so we're trying to make sure that there's that, at the key point, the right time to enable that credit to be awarded.
So we've got another question online, if that's okay. But Rose, I want to plant a seed because I want to come back to you with the question here shortly, and that is with you here. I want to take advantage of your knowledge base about Penn State in our relationship to FutureLearn and where you see things going. So in a second, can I come back to you on that? Is that okay?
Excellent.
So Mark, Dr. Andrea Gregg, I forgot to mention, I say that sort of, well, yeah. It's not tongue-in-cheek. She's recently received her information, her degree, and part of her work was around content analysis and understanding the kinds and the depth of this dialogue going on in the social space. And she's asking, have you done any content analysis on these conversations that are, as you said, so rich and varied? Is there, it's one thing to see lots of attaboys and good boys. Is anyone gone in and looked at the depth of that conversation?
They are looking, and it's not something I can point to, but the best thing I can do is for that follow-up is there are lots of research activities going on amongst that academic network. So what would be FutureLearn, and is hands-off, so it's called the FutureLearn Academic Network, but it's run, it's chaired by the Open University and run by the academics. So all we do, we're providing a facilitation and umbrella, but they dictate their agenda, and it's enabled them to bid for funds and other things with an identity. So there are papers that they're producing. So we as a routine on every course, do sort of semantic analysis and sentiment analysis of all the courses to see what are people saying, where it's good and whatever. But it's up to the individual universities now who are pursuing that research. And they are, because we give you all that data. It's all yours to plow through. But yeah, there's a lot of that work going.
So Rose, one second on your question. Roy asks, so it's a tag into this. Roy asks, have you applied any artificial intelligence into this data that you have in your shop?
So no, and there are lots of talks about doing things like that, because there's also all those new big systems coming out. I can't remember whether it's Microsoft or and others that they've got all these new artificial intelligence sort of things that can respond. I think we'd love to do some of that and see if it would work, but again, it's what's it designed to do? Because again, that goes into the mindset of answering questions. And actually, part of what we want in conversation is not to end up with the right answer, but it's the discussion that you want. So I think it depends on what you really want out of this technology. Some of it can be great labor-saving devices, but it may not be improving what you want it to improve. So I think there's roles for it. It's not, we have to prioritize what we think is really important. That's not yet the most important thing to do.
Well, maybe when you're ready for that, I'd suggest we maybe pull Roy in here and make some connections. So let me broaden the discussion just a little bit. And Rose and Mark, if you would just share with us Penn State's interest in FutureLearn and what's on the plate by way of projects, I think would be of interest to our community.
Sure. How public are we with COIL?
Pretty public.
We are in the closing moments of our contract.
Yep. So we're working on that?
We're working on that. We have already started a lot of discussions with the colleges. And one of the, well, some of the areas that have the greatest interest that I'll just lay out there are the ability for the Google indexing. That's huge. The ability around the social constructivism and the engagement, because as we're seeing in more and more grant situations, what they're talking about is very much how are you taking your learnings to the world and engaging, and I think that's really important, engaging the world in the dialogue. As we know, we have five themes of excellence here at the university. We are very much focusing on those five themes. Not that the others aren't important, it's just that we want to be known for five specific things, right? One of them being transforming education, which all of these dialogues is deeply embedded in, the desire to have partnerships, to be able to tap into like-minded institutions who are exploring, expanding, and transforming education is extraordinarily important to us. And I think that, you know, people like Craig Weideman and Robert Pangborn are all very sensitive to the fact that alone we can do so much, but together with great thinking institutions, we can change the world and the way the world learns. And we're very excited about that. So there's a transforming education piece. There's the community and personalized education and health, the health portion of what we're doing. We're in dialogue there. There is the stewarding of the world's resources. There's a lot of traction there. We're going to be at EMS later on today discussing several projects with them. One of them which involves one of my favorite people, Richard Alley, and his work on climate change and how that impacts the world. We're working with WPSU on an NSF grant right now that is highly confidential, so I can't talk about it, but it's very, very exciting in the energy realm with regards to stewarding the world's resources. So then we've got the whole cultures arena, and that one is more nascent, but I think that there are areas where we can bring our technology into play with FutureLearn. We have some of the foremost experts in the world in sonification. Is there a way that we can enhance their product with our products? I mean, one of the really nice things about FutureLearn is this community of thinkers and their willingness and ability to share and to develop and build upon each other's thinking. Another key area is the whole arena of B2B. As you guys probably know, we've been expanding our B2B quite aggressively in the past year. What do we offer them that is within our existing course line, and what do we supplement with partners content? So there's been a lot of discussion because FutureLearn has been building portfolios of learning for businesses through a mix of the different universities that they work with, and we absolutely wanted to take advantage of that. So these are some of the discussions that are currently underway, and we're really excited about adding this to our overall mix because we think it's significantly different from others. Also, we've got some content envy. We've got NPR obviously here, which is an amazing reserve for us that we can pull content from to enrich our courses. I don't know if we've done that as much as we could or want to. Kate Domikos here in the room, so this is just a very obvious plug. But the thing that originally interested me in FutureLearn was I was on the BBC, and I saw an article about women warriors of World War I. And all of the content was from the BBC, but they said in the midst of it, Dr. So-and-so, who's the expert on women warriors in World War I, is doing a MOOC, click here. And I was like, whoa, wait a minute, BBC, what? You know, a MOOC is linked into the BBC, and what the BBC is doing in their partnership with FutureLearn is they're deepening the engagement of their viewership by attaching MOOCs to that content. So I think to myself, how can we work with NPR? How can we work with other players in the news industry or the education industry to deepen their experience and the engagement of their customers with things like this? So it runs the gambit to answer the question, Larry. I'm sorry.
It's okay, Rose.
But it's very exciting to us because of the level of engagement.
I want to turn to Jessica. Was there another one?
Yeah,
Jess.
She's got it.
Thanks for all the practical information today. I found it really useful. I actually have two questions, so hopefully that's all right.
Yeah.
The first one is, I definitely see it valuable starting a conversation around researchers who are coming up with new information in the institution, which needs to get out. I was wondering also, though, if you've had any success creating conversations with current experts in the field, as in like companies, and having them actually engage with a university in a partnership type of scenario to keep the conversation going even after a course ends. So that's my first question. And then my second question is, often when we talk about MOOCs, you're right, we focus on the M, and we talk about scalability, but I've also heard the other side of it from the instructor's side, that the instructor is the unit, and that's the part that doesn't scale. You can really still only expect the instructor to respond to so many students in a course. So how have you got around that scalability to actually be able to scale?
Okay, so first question, as I said, so there's, have we worked with universities and companies where you've got a learning experience and then the students carry on and continue a dialogue after the course is finished? Is that right? Okay. So we haven't, on our platform, there's no community space yet for that to go on. And it's been identified as something actually from business schools that they would really like, because it's creating your alumni and another learning community for other things. So that's something that's on our agenda. So actually, straight short answer is no. But one of the things about this is, where are they likely to want to go as well? Because actually there's so many, there's LinkedIn groups, there's their own internal company systems, you know, there's Facebook, there's lots of places where people can go and naturally want to go. So what you've got to do is make sure whatever you're going to put forward for them is really good. Now there's some places like IMD as a business school that do, you know, fantastic alumni management. You know, they've got those spaces. And what draws people back is not the fact that they can talk. It's the fact that they're being given a stream of new materials, great webinars, thought leadership pieces, So it's not the physical, it's not the virtual space, it's the reasons to go back to it that matter so much. So that's the, so and without that content there, it's having the space would be limited in effect. So that's the only thing I would say. The other question, which, sorry, it's just coming out of my hand, to try and, if you could refresh my memory. Scalability, yes. So yeah, tutors are the point of failure in scaling, right? So, but that's, again, it goes back to the point, what are they there to do, right, at that level, you know, at scale? And I think it's not to answer questions. It is to selectively prod, provoke within the learning design as much. You're designing an experience predicated on the fact that you can't do that, but you still want to get your learners to discuss it. And what we find is, if we've done sort of network mapping, you take a course where an educator tries to be all over it, the students love it. They think, wow, how attentive you've been for a free course. We couldn't expect that. And so the feedback's fantastic. But it took them so much time. And they said, well, I can't repeat that. I'll never do that again. Right? Because, you know, look at the commitment. So their expectation about what they need to do changes. And when you look at the network mapping, it shows all nodes leading into the one individual. As soon as the educator steps back, the vacuum is filled, and it's multi-nodal, the network mapping. Some of the key individuals who are knowledgeable, who talk, and are actually valued, people start to follow them. The conversations start to link to them. And you don't need, when you have thousands of people, even hundreds of people, the educator doesn't need to be there to answer those questions. A lot of them are clarifying understanding. Well, there's people to help you clarify understanding. If you want to, I don't know how to get this to work, I'm not sure about that, somebody's going to answer that for you. You're not the fountain of all knowledge that has to solve every issue. And you don't, arguably, I'd say you're not doing that for most of your students on campus. So don't expect to be doing it with even larger numbers virtually. So it's understanding how the crowd can work to your advantage and knowing how your most value can be added. And that is not, as I said, answering every question. So scaling is, and if you want to provide better support, people have recruited other students from past runs of the course to say, you know, would you want to help mentor? So you're not an official educator, but could you mentor some others? And some are actually really happy to do it. No
currency is status.
Correct. And the more we can build systems to recognize that status, the better.
Terrific. Well, I'm sorry to report that we're out of time. This has been just a marvelous dialogue. Thank you so much for joining us, both Rose and Mark.
Thank you, guys.